I'm Professor Vinod Pavarala. I teach communication at the University of Hyderabad in India. Last 5 years, I've also been serving as the UNESCO Chair on Community Media. The chair primarily tries to promote the cause of community media globally through research and policy advocacy and capacity building. This is my first time in the region. Although through friends here, I have been reading up on what is happening in Cameroon, in Sierra Leone, and the region as a whole. It's never the same, you know. So coming here personally, meeting people, visiting radio stations, talking to station representatives, gives you a more sobering picture of what is happening here. I admire the work that's being done here by community media practitioners. I think they are working against a lot of odds. There are many challenges, the weak democratic structures, there are issues of financial sustainability, there is the very real issue of security and safety of community media personnel, the lack of proper economic development. So people here are working against a lot of odds, and it's not the same in some other countries where things are fairly secure on a fairly stable platform. So it might be relatively easier to do community media in some places compared to here. So I have developed a lot of respect for the work that's going on here. No, I think I've learnt a lot from my interactions in Sierra Leone and also in Cameroon, and in Cameroon talking to stations from DRC. I've learnt a lot about what community media can potentially do for peace building, to report on conflicts in a sensitive manner. I mean, of course, one has read a lot of theory, a lot of case studies from other countries. For example, a region like Latin America, where community media have been used to build peace by communities. And so I have always believed that community media do play a very central role in peace building, and that view is reinforced even more being here in Western Central Africa. And some of these are real hard conflicts. I mean, it's also a question of survival of communities, sheer safety and security of individuals against the might of the state, against the might sometimes of big corporations. In Sierra Leone, for example, I've learned about the whole land grabbing issue, where big international companies are coming in to acquire land in a big way for mining, for other commercial crops, which don't really benefit the local communities. And it's a big threat to food security. I think these are the real issues of conflict, also around issues of democracy, issues of covering elections, holding authorities accountable in terms of governance. These are very significant issues which need to be dealt with a great deal of sensitivity, with the right amount of credibility, using journalistic techniques, but making sure that it is done with the communities, by the communities, for the communities, in a sensitive manner, in a participatory manner. Ultimately, it is the communities that need to benefit from your peace building journalism or activity. I was very impressed yesterday to watch this fascinating video made by people in DRC in collaboration with their counterparts in Rwanda. You know, young people, four of them, getting together to talk about peace, asking Africa to stand up and rise above conflict. I think that was a powerful video, and that really is the way forward for communities to work for peace in this region. Complicated issue. I mean, no matter where I go in the world, including to stations in India, sustainability issue is uppermost in everybody's minds, and I think for a good reason. But what I've been saying everywhere is to understand sustainability in a slightly broader way, not just reduce it to financial sustainability. I think there is the issue of social sustainability, very importantly, meaning that there is a buy-in for your radio station from the community that you want to serve, that the community cares about this station, that the community feels that they own this station. I mean, if not legally, at least emotionally, they have a link to this station, that they feel it's a very vital tool in their own community building activity. Unless that social sustainability is there, no other sustainability can make stations survive. And of course, financial sustainability is a very key issue. A lot of stations in this region, Western Central Africa, like in other parts of the developing world, seem to be dependent heavily on donor agencies, on well-meaning NGOs, which are trying to advocate a cause, and they see community radio as an important instrument to further that cause. I mean, these are good causes and there are good NGOs, there's no doubt about it. But the stations realize that, and I don't need to tell them this, that NGO funding, donor funding is not going to be forever, right? Many of them work around projects. Many of them are working to enable stations to stand on their own feet. And I think that is the direction to go. Use donor funding, NGO funding if necessary. Work on sustainability in the future. Because what happens when the funding dries up? What can the community contribute to the station? And I know that many of these stations are serving very poor communities, communities living in extreme poverty. So they are not in a position to contribute monetarily all the time. But there are good examples from different parts of the world where poor communities are contributing, you know, even a dollar a month or something towards the community, towards the community radio station, whatever they can, so that there is a collective sense of ownership of that community. So community contribution is not just to give all the money required to let the station run, but is also to gain a sense of ownership. But I think you also need to look at things like advertising. I believe in some countries, advertising is not permitted under the licensing regime. I think we need to lobby with the government to permit some amount of advertising, not to make the station profitable, but at least to make it survive and sustainable. There can be limits on how much advertising, but advertising for local products, local services is part of community service. A small shopkeeper, somebody who produces a local product should be able to advertise in this station for a small amount of money. Similarly, a local factory wants to advertise new jobs. You know, why not use this community radio station to advertise for that? So one needs to look at advertising, community contributions, local businesses, perhaps NGO support for a while, perhaps through projects that the station runs from time to time, to talk about issues that matter to its communities. So one has to look at a diversity of funding sources to move away from a monolithic funding structure. I think that's the way to move forward. The smallest level, which is the level of the village, the level of the station. A station should never be feeling alone if that immediate community is with them. Yeah, you build solidarity with the community that you're working with to begin with, right? I mean, people in that community should be able to say, we are not going to let this station shut down. It belongs to all of us. It is serving a vital role for us, and we will work to its survival and sustainability, right? That's the first thing. Having said that, communities can also feel fairly isolated and alone. And that's where external linkages, external networks come in. And I have been a very strong advocate for stations belonging to networks of other stations, peer groups, from whom one has a lot to learn from their experiences, their sustainability experiments, and the way they produce content. And sometimes issues are similar from one station to the other. And community radio stations need not feel that they are in competition with each other. They are never in competition with each other. It is not a market where you are trying to get a share of the market, right? I mean, you are in it together on a common set of issues. You know, we have talked about issues like corruption, on governance, on accountability, on land grabbing. I mean, these are common issues that matter to everybody. This is where stations working together to co-produce content, and if not co-produce, at least things that you produce in your station, you can share with other stations, and where language is not a barrier. You know, if it is all English speaking, it is all French speaking, Creole speaking in Sierra Leone, it's easy to share content. So content sharing is a big issue. Sharing of experiences, I already mentioned on issues like sustainability. How do you manage volunteers? We have much to learn. Also, some stations, because of the sheer number of years that they have been in existence, have something to offer to other stations in terms of skills, in terms of capacities, and maybe a peer station could play a leading role in helping share capacities. I don't want to use a word like building capacities, but sharing capacities with your fellow stations, right? So for this, it's very crucial to have a national network to which all stations can belong, to advocate for an enabling policy environment with the government, but also work as a peer learning platform where stations meet regularly, become friends, share things with each other, and give strength to each other so that you don't feel alone. Similarly, it's also important to take the network to the next level. So friends here in this part of the world have been talking about a regional network, and I've been happy to participate in these discussions to form a West and Central Africa network. I think that's a great idea. I mean, Africa is a huge continent. Things do differ from one sub-region to the other, and it's good to have regional networks. There is already an East Africa community media network. Perhaps there are similar networks in other parts of Africa. So if you have a regional coalition where you scale up issues to a regional level, then you can have inter-regional collaborations. East African networks working with West African networks, again, on similar ideas of giving strength, sharing experiences on a higher platform. And these regional groups can become part of international networks, like the World Association of Community Radio Broadcasters, AMARC, is one such network. Maybe there are others. There are similar things in Europe, for example, right? So how can we become networked to share tools, to share ideas, content, capacities together? And there's no better way than becoming a network. From my experience, a lot of community radio stations are so busy struggling to run their stations on a day-to-day basis, finding strategies to survive, you know, get volunteers, produce content on a daily basis, that they don't have enough time to pause, reflect, document their experience, and they can do with some support on that. And I think when I have also mentioned networking and exchanges, sometimes it's not always possible to physically meet all the time. There are expenses involved, there is time away from your station. So it's always good to see how we can leverage IT you know, that's available to create online platforms where they can exchange, share stories, find ways of documenting their experiences, perhaps share content, right? And there are such platforms in other parts of the world. And I'm happy to hear that something like that is being proposed for this region called the Community Media Archive. That will be an excellent location for communities to put together their profiles, to become a little more visible to each other. and to put up their content for others to download and play on their stations. So all the things that I mentioned that a network can do can actually be facilitated through an online archive platform like this one. No, I'm just the three countries about which I have heard, two countries I have visited. I think the potential is immense. I mean, I hear a number like 400 stations in the DRC, about 100 stations here in Cameroon, maybe about 30-40 stations in Sierra Leone. Just these three countries, we are looking at 500 to 600 stations. Yes, of course, which one of these are really community radio stations, what categories do they belong to? I mean, even if the number is half of this number, it's still a significant number. And the potential for these stations to make a difference in their respective countries and in the region together is huge. It's power to the people to come together and work as a network in solidarity. I mean, issues like democratization. I mean, it's such a crucial issue. I mean, wherever I'm going, I'm hearing the issue of another election round the corner, whether that election will be free and fair. What can community radios do to ensure that? And there are great examples from other parts of Africa. Tanzania, for example, the 26 community radio stations worked together a couple of years ago as an election monitoring system where they also educated the voters about their rights as citizens to vote and to vote in an informed fashion. So that's one area right there. But Africa as a continent, this region is going through a tremendous process of social and economic change. Development is a big thing. Investments are coming in. Big countries are now beginning to show an interest in Africa. Leaders in these countries are talking of wanting to take the countries to the next level with higher growth rates. But someone needs to speak on behalf of the communities. Someone needs to speak on behalf of the poor, those who are not in a position to fend for themselves in this rapid process of development, right? And that's where community radios can play a role. To speak on behalf of the voiceless, to speak on behalf of the marginalized in this whole process of development. The country needs to take these people along in that path of development. And I think community radios can play a great role in doing that.